Hi, I'm Kumi Taguchi. Tonight on Insight, what happens after you get hurt at work? Hello, thank you so much for being here. Anita, hi. Early one morning, while you were doing your job as a paramedic in rural Victoria, something very unexpected happened to you. Can you tell us about that day?
A normal night shift at work, got called to a job at 4 o'clock in the morning and went in to assess the patient that had called us and called 000 for help. And an unfortunate turn of events, the patient became very aggressive very, very quickly, and I ended up with a dislocated shoulder and being hospitalised after the patient attacked me.
Anita, you're the mother of three young children, yeah. And your husband was at home in bed at the time. What was going through your mind when this happened to you?
I think it was probably a couple of hours afterwards when I was in hospital, that realisation that I wasn't going to be home in time to do the tag team of James getting to work and me doing school drop-off. And I think the opening line of my text message was something like, I'm okay, but I'm not going to be home in time to get the kids to school. Yeah.
In your job as a paramedic, you've probably come across that kind of intersection between your job and violence. Did you ever imagine that this kind of thing would happen to you?
No, I've been in the job nearly 14 years and have witnessed aggressive patients and aggressive bystanders, but have never personally been affected by physical violence in the workplace before.
James, you're Anita's husband. You got that text early in the morning saying, I'm okay, but...
Yeah.
What was that like for you?
Well, it's something very different to wake up to, I guess. We knew she was going to be there for some time. So, just getting ready to start the day and get the kids off to school and then wait to hear an update.
When you went to see Anita, how did she look?
Like someone who'd been through the ringer, in pain, on drugs, couldn't get the pain under control. So that took quite a bit of time. Yeah.
Anita, when the senior manager at the station found out what had happened to you, how did he respond?
I'm pretty sure that someone got him out of bed at 6 o'clock in the morning, and within about 15 minutes he was there. He's not even my manager. He's the manager of the branch that I was working at that night. And he went into almost like, you know, your dad mode. His initial response was, who's got the kids? Where's James? What do you need us to do? Where's your car parked? Like really good practical things, which is what I needed at that stage so that my life could continue because I should have been home by then. Yeah.
And what did that response mean to you at the time?
A huge amount. It felt really supportive, which is what I needed. Mm.
Thanks, Anita. Thank you. Yash, hi.
Okay.
You came to Australia from Iran with your family when you were 6 years old. At just 15, you started work in a fast food restaurant. What did that role mean to you?
It was an important role for me because it was me supporting my mother and my two younger siblings at that time. Coming from a country where you don't really get the opportunity to work, your life's pretty much set out for you. Me not sort of going down the normal path of what's expected of you was different for me, and that's why that sort of became the pathway of my life from that young age of 15.
And you were financially supporting your mum at this stage?
Yes.
What was it like then for that to become your career path?
It was never intentionally my career path to start off with at the age of 15. It was working five shifts a week, trying to make $300 a fortnight, going to school. I was in year 11 at that age, so it was sort of trying to balance out being at home, support mum, but also get my education.
Yash, that sense of independence that you talk about, was that an important sort of part of your identity that you maybe hadn't have anticipated?
It was, because I had to make sure there was a roof over our heads no matter what. So it was never a question of me stopping work going forward, regardless of what the circumstances had come through for me.
And you rose through the ranks quite quickly.
I did. So I became full-time at 16 and I got offered a contracted salary as a junior assistant manager at 17.
Wow.
Just had to make sure there was another manager in the store because of not being of age to monitor team members in the store.
Yash, you had a series of workplace injuries, the first one when you were 19. What happened?
I was working on a shift, usually ends around 5 o'clock. Second manager coming in to take over at 3. Second manager came in but wasn't feeling too well, so they decided to leave for the day. I was walking around the store trying to finish team members and get the new ones to get into their roles, and a team member had asked for help with a piece of machinery that was stuck. Now, at 5 o'clock, when it's peak hour, I just knew that that product that we're cooking is going to get burnt if I don't get to it. So walked straight to it. It exploded, hit me in the face. I didn't feel the hit. I felt the burn on my arms. And all I remember is just looking down at my arms and the floor just going red. But I didn't know where that was coming from. And then the team members just looked at me and they just start screaming. All I remember was just being taken to the sink area and just tried to run my arms under cold water until the ambulance came and I was taken to hospital.
You went back to work 3 weeks later and you didn't make a claim. Did you consider that as an option?
No, never thought of it.
Why not?
Because the place I was working for was like family to me, and that was an inconvenience. It was made to believe that someone who claims gets frowned upon. You know, you don't cause extra charges or budgets or labour or expenses for the business. Because I didn't want to be paid while being at home. I wanted to be paid for working. I wasn't even thinking of it or considering it because I just wanted to be back at work. I felt negligent. I felt guilty because the team members had seen what had happened. The customers wouldn't have been served for those few hours, and you know, I felt like I was at fault because I've just, you know, become an inconvenience to that company.
Were you made to feel like you were at fault?
I believe over the years, and as I grew older, I do believe that some of the things that were said and done in a certain way did make me feel that way.
All this time, Yash, you're continuing to build your career amongst all this. The pressures and responsibilities were kind of continuing to pile up. What was that like?
The amount of days that I'd wake up and look at the ceiling and think, do I need this? I moved out of home very young. I was on my own from a very young age, and it was more of a people wanting me or wanting someone like me from a Middle Eastern culture that moves out, who's not married, who is financially independent, who doesn't rely on any other person for their own life. They're just waiting for that person to fail, and I couldn't let that be me. So no matter the days that I had, the exhaustion, I was never going to lose what I had built, which was buying my first home and having that as something that I built. It's mine. I did it by myself. I did it with every bit of sweat that I had.
You were starting to struggle emotionally too. How did you know that that was happening?
It was a series of breakdowns that I started recognising. And as much as I'm the type of person that whatever you throw at me, I'll come up with a solution. Whatever responsibilities were given to me over the years, just take it on and handle it, juggle it however you have to. It got to about 2017 where I realised I was burning out. I realised that I can't continue. I actually need help. So for the first time, I asked for help. And when I did ask for help, their response was, are you sure you're not just depressed?
Right. You didn't feel validated on that level?
No.
7 years after your first injury, you were hurt a second time. This was lifting boxes of frozen food. Now, these are large, heavy boxes,
yep.
right?
Yeah.
Did you have any help?
No. No. It would have been a Monday morning going into work at 7 a.m. and by 8:30, I knew I wasn't going to be okay.
You had a pinch in your neck at this stage, right?
At 8:30, I felt pinching in my right side. I remember being like, this isn't what I used to. Like, the aches and back pains, they're a normal thing. But you just work through it and you just go home and you sleep it off. And this was worse than anything I felt. And that's when I made that first call for help.
How bad, Yash, did the injury get?
By about midday, I couldn't move the right side of my body. I was still at work. I had asked my team members if, instead of me being the person running around, if I could be at the counter doing the register, because I physically cannot move my right side. And it would have been about 5 o'clock I got to leave to go seek medical attention. And by that time, I couldn't even drive myself. So I had to get picked up to go to a doctor at that time.
And after all this, you still stayed in that job, right?
Yes.
Anita, after the attack, you were physically unable to work at all for 3 months. How did you feel about that?
Originally, I thought I'd be back at work the following week. I had this silly idea in my head that I'd be out of a sling in 3 days and back to full capacity, and realised really quickly that that wasn't going to be the case. And I felt that I had no control over anything at all. I couldn't drive. I couldn't do simple mum tasks at home, such as fold washing or wash the children's hair or prepare a meal. And I just felt useless.
You were also struggling emotionally.
Yeah.
Did you think that would be a big part of your recovery at that time?
No, but I look back now and realise that I was in a really dark and angry place, and I was not a nice person looking back after it happened. I had a huge amount of fear. I didn't want to walk down the street in case I ran into this bloke, which is, I now know, a ridiculous thing to be scared of. But it affected all facets of my life.
Was that emotional side of the injury harder, the same as the physical injury?
The emotional side of it's far harder because you can't prove it, people can't see it. And so there was sort of this attitude of going, well, you're nearly out of the sling, you'll be fine now. But that's probably when the fear and the panic got worse, because I felt that I had to go straight back to being in the ambulance and straight back to doing my job, and I couldn't cope with that.
Being a paramedic, was that sort of emotional injury nearly harder to justify than the physical one?
Absolutely, and I think probably my harshest critic has been myself.
Right.
We get on with our job, we deal with emergencies every day, and that's just part of our job. And so I expected myself to just get on with it and get over it, and I couldn't.
You wanted to return to work mm-hmm. after being attacked on the job. Yeah. Why?
Because I love my job. I love what I do. I'm good at what I do, and I really want to do it again. And I'm not letting someone ruin my career for, you know, 5 seconds of anger.
Mary, you're a doctor who assesses injured workers. How are our workers' compensation schemes currently set up to help people after injuries like these?
Broadly, there's a legislative, rule-based structure designed to assist people who've had a work injury with replacing part of their wages, a percentage of their wages, medical expenses, and there are other various components of the system.
And are the schemes different when you look at different states as well? So depending where you're injured depends on the kind of assistance you might get?
Absolutely. Each state has its own scheme, and then there's a scheme for the national federal bodies. Then some large employers are also self-insurers.
And the aim of the schemes overall is to get people back to work, right?
Yes. Schemes will cover extra medical costs with the aim of actually providing extra support so we can get people back to work. It doesn't always work that way, but the intent is there.
Mary, what does the research tell us about what actually works when getting people back into a job after an injury.
So what makes a difference is employer support. That's the biggest influence on whether somebody goes back to work or not. That early care, take them to the doctor, help them with the practical issues, make sure they feel supported. So the return to work coordinator at the workplace or the line manager and supervisor, their attitudes and approach has an enormous impact.
So what then makes it harder for people to get back to work?
It's helping them navigate what has become a complex, multifaceted scheme, which is challenging for people to deal with. Those sort of things help people. The difficulty we have is that putting these things into practice, the implementation, is enormously challenging. Mm. Whether it's the employer's attitude, whether it's how the doctor treats the person, what's the forms that need to be signed, all of those things can become facilitators or they can become barriers to helping people get back to work. And more processes complicate the situation and are a detraction.
Mary, is there an issue here too of some people being perceived that they don't want to return to work, they're trying to rot the system, they're trying to just get paid while they're not going to the job? Is that a problem here as well?
Huge. Huge. There are workers who do naughty things, there are employers who do naughty things, and there are service providers like health professionals or rehabilitation professionals, the insurers, the lawyers, all of the people involved in the scheme. There is naughtiness. And it is so important to address it, and it's not addressed well enough, because if we don't address it, the system loses trust. And so everyone is questioned. There's a very small percentage of people who do the wrong thing. That's small in terms of workers, small in terms of workplaces, but it needs to be dealt with because it has an outside effect.
My employer was fabulous, but the insurance side of it has been incredibly difficult to deal with.
The compensation will never give me my full health back.
Katrina, you shifted your career in your mid-40s and trained as a beauty therapist. What was your plan?
My plan was to transition out of the corporate world into a more nurturing environment and change my career path from there on.
You've been dealing with a claim for about 3 years now. Yeah. After you were hurt at work, what were your injuries?
3 years ago when I was initially diagnosed, it was for carpal tunnel syndrome. It was a gruelling environment where I was working about 40 hours a week and back-to-back facials, waxing, eyelash, eyebrow tinting. And it didn't take long before, I guess, those symptoms came along. All the while I was getting some symptoms and pain underneath my right shoulder blade. I believed it was muscular and getting massages for it, but that wasn't looked at. And when I went to see a doctor and was assessed for carpal tunnel, it had been noted earlier that I had reported a neck pain, but never was that investigated any further.
So you had surgery for the carpal tunnel syndrome. What sort of happened after that?
The symptoms didn't completely disappear. The intense pain did, but the numbness and the pins and needles remained in my right hand. And the pain underneath my right shoulder blade continued to intensify. Eventually, the pain got so intense, it impacted my life in every way possible. I ended up in a doctor's surgery who called an ambulance because I was in so much pain. And later, after having an MRI, found that I had a large disc herniation in my spine. And at that point, they said that's compressing on the same nerve that is actually connected with your carpal tunnel down your median nerve. That's when I figured this must all be connected.
So you got surgery to replace and fuse those discs. Was WorkCover willing to cover that part of your injury?
No, they ignored my request for them to look at it for many, many months. I ended up having to go through the public system as a Category 1 priority it took about 12 months, I guess, before I finally got a response from WorkCover as to whether or not they'll accept liability of my claim to add my neck injury to my claim, even though they had a letter from my treating doctor stating that she believed that they were absolutely connected. They used just a random doctor's report to say they weren't related and I had never been physically assessed by a specialist.
Katrina, how was this impacting your family, your close relationships?
They've watched me deteriorate emotionally. I lost my career. I had plans to have my own business, work in Medispa and do more high-end treatments. I had created a business name. I had this vision of a future that was pulled out from underneath me, and that wasn't what I planned for after, you know, 2.5 years of training.
Have you been able to work at all since your injury?
I started working or volunteering at a not-for-profit charity organisation a bit over a year ago now. For my own mental health, I was going stir-crazy, and I'm limited in the hours that I can work now. So I can't ever work beyond probably what my ability is now, which is going to limit my future income, which is a huge concern for me.
So you're receiving workers' compensation payments for your wrist injury, but not your neck injury?
No, they won't.
Where has all this left you financially?
In a quandary. I don't know what my financial future is going to look like. It looks bleak at this point, because as soon as I'm taken off work cover, I'm left with an income that's going to leave me below the poverty line, leave me with not enough money for treatments, for what I need physically, what I need emotionally, and potentially homeless. I mean, I can only work, you know, 18 hours a week, so that's not a lot to live on.
Thank you, Katrina, so much for sharing. Thank you.
Thank you.
Anita, how did your physical injury affect your day-to-day life?
That inability to just live a normal functioning life. Initially, I obviously had an arm in a sling for a couple of months. With my right arm, I'm right arm dominant. So couldn't drive, can't go supermarket, couldn't do household duties. But then when I did return to work with light duties, I'm still not back to full active duties because my arm's not strong enough to be able to take the weight that's required to be able to do my role as a paramedic. So it's had lots of effects.
How were you doing emotionally at this stage?
So about 4 or 5 months after my attack, the psychologist that I was working with at Ambulance Victoria said to me, I'd like to refer you to another psychologist for some PTSD testing, which was ultimately life-changing for me, yeah.
Why was it life-changing?
So I met with a new psychologist in end of October, start of November, and went through a whole series of questionnaires and tests. And she said to me, I believe that you've got PTSD. And it was a bit of a, oh, I'm not crazy. This is okay. But also, this isn't going to be me forever, this horrible anxiety or these flashbacks. There's treatment for it, and lots of people have this, and there's a way forward. Yeah, it sort of made me feel not quite so crazy.
Anita, you needed to see a physio for your shoulder and a psychologist for the PTSD. To get compensated, you had to contact Victoria's compensation scheme. What was that experience like for you?
Awful. There's no nice way around it. You're a number, you're not a person. When you email them, you don't put your name in the subject line, you put your number that you've been given. You become a statistic. I've had 3 different caseworkers in 9 months, and every one of them has had a different approach, different ideas, have said they're going to do something and that hasn't happened, have questioned my need to use a psychologist on a regular basis or use the psychologist I was already seeing. it really much feels like it's about the money, it's about the insurance side of it. It's not at all a human approach to a person and their life, and it's not just about work, it's about their entire life and as a whole. Yeah.
Did you feel like your claims for compensation were treated as valid?
The shoulder injury, yes, because it's easy to prove. You know, we've got an MRI and we've got GP's reports and a physio's reports, but the psychological injury, I got questioned on whether or not I needed the treatment, and I shouldn't have to justify that to a caseworker who's ticking a box to make a payment so that I could keep receiving treatment. My employer was fabulous and has been fabulous in supporting me throughout, but the insurance side of it has been incredibly difficult to deal with. You feel like you have to prove yourself. You are constantly trying to defend yourself and defend why you're doing things, and they'll say, "Oh, but, you know, why aren't you back at work yet? And you know, your physio's nearly cleared you. You should be good to go back." Well, I'm not psychologically ready to go back yet. Yeah.
You mentioned your employer, Ambulance Victoria. They provided a return to work coordinator for you.
Yes.
Did that make things easier for you?
Oh my goodness, yes. Without her, I wouldn't be where I am now. From I think I got a phone call from her a day after the attack, and she introduced herself as a return to work coordinator. On day five, she organised home help for me through the Shire so that at least we had someone to be able to do the washing and the cleaning so family life could continue. When I did start back at work, it was practical things such as a sit-stand desk and making sure that my colleagues knew what I was up to and where I was going, meeting with me every fortnight to discuss how I'm coping, how I'm feeling, chasing up the insurance company to say, no, why has she not been reimbursed for the MRI? Why is she not being reimbursed for a travel? No, this needs to be done. She was that absolute go-between between my physical work life and the insurance company. So it wasn't me having to try and follow the insurance company up. She did that. She's been the voice of reason in saying, no, let's keep you on day shifts for now. Let's put you as a third up paramedic in the ambulance to support you with that transition back to work. It's a really supportive role, and I'm incredibly thankful to her. Yeah.
Rebecca, you're an executive for Ambulance Victoria. You say your organisation's approach to workplace injuries is different from other organisations. Why is that?
Over the last 5 years, we've gone through a total review and relook around how we manage injury at work, both physically and psychologically. Previously, it was just a tick the box, let's go through the motions, you know, we've got to get people back to work. Where, you know, we're in the business of providing care to the community. And we have models of care that our paramedics work to around patient safety and the best, you know, person-centred care models for how we deal with our patients. And we have translated that into how we care for our people. Now, we don't get it right all the time. You know, it's a big organisation across the state of Victoria, but we really test ourselves as an organisation to make sure that we are doing everything possible to be able to support our injured workers and learning from when we don't. I think that's the important part. You know, it's easy for me to sit here and, you know, I'm in an executive role saying, yes, you know, this is what we do. But if we get feedback from our paramedics like Anita that things aren't working, then we need to be knocking on the door of our insurers and our treating practitioners and asking questions.
When you joined Ambulance Victoria, there wasn't a health and safety action plan. There wasn't a mental health action plan. Why was change in this area so important to you?
It is important to me, and it's, I think, you know, when we joined, we normalised injury. You know, emergency services and healthcare, you know, it's just part of the job. But when I came in, I thought it's actually not part of the job. And the reason is, you know, people like Anita and my colleagues across the state, they have families, they have children, and they need to, you know, they shouldn't have to come to work and be injured. That actually impacts how they live their life. And it's something that's very personal to me. Because I know what I would expect and what I, for my family members in an organisation, and I feel accountable that families of Ambulance Victoria should expect the same of me. We have an executive and our CEO who is very, very passionate and holds us accountable as executives for the mental health and wellbeing and the safety of our workforce.
How hard has it been to make all these changes?
I could sit here and talk to you about this for days. It is hard. It is hard because it's hard on, it's complex on a number of different levels. So it's complex As it's been highlighted today, from an insurance perspective, you've got a regulatory environment that, you know, you've got to do this at this stage of the injury, you've got to fill out this form, you can't get this reimbursed. So what organisations like ours want to do in putting in different care models, it rubs up against it. Mm. So we've had to really work with our insurer about how we would like to care and work with our people.
Thanks, Rebecca.
Thank you.
Yash, hearing this and the sort of support Anita had early on, is this the kind of help that you got from your employer?
No, I wish. It was very difficult because, like Anita had mentioned, everything becomes a number. 12 years of employment, the bonds that you build, the relationships that you build, it just changes completely with the accident. It more so becomes an inconvenience. I felt like an inconvenience to them, but still wanting to be back at work, still going back to work on light duties. Even on the light duties that I was advised by my physiotherapist over the time, I wasn't given the opportunity to be able to adhere to those light duties in order to heal. Instead, it actually got more aggravated over the time.
Mary, you've done research on state insurance schemes. How do we measure if they're working or not?
One common measure is whether people return to work, the percentage of people who go back to work. And that is probably a proxy for their health, but we don't measure health outcomes, which would be an excellent thing to be doing. The other way schemes are assessed is money. Mm. So it might be the average premium rate across the scheme and the amount of money that the scheme has in surplus or is unfunded.
We've heard about the high turnover of caseworkers in some cases. What do you think is going on there?
Yeah, it's a big conversation that we need to have at a national level about case management. So if you have an injury and you've lodged a claim, at the other end of the claim will be someone who needs to manage that claim, the case manager. They're called different things in different schemes. Now, how that case manager operates is not determined by that case manager, it's determined by the system that they're operating within. And so that then in turn depends on the policymakers and their views about the importance of case management. So if they see case management as really important, they put structures around it. So how many cases are you managing? So what pay level are case managers receiving? How are they trained? So the structures around case managers determine their turnover. Mm-hmm. And so it affects people when you have multiple case managers. Three is not all that many in Victoria. So the case manager is really important and we just don't recognise it enough.
Katrina, you've brought a law firm on to work on your case. Why did you decide to do that?
I brought a law firm on because I didn't have a lot of faith in WorkCover. I thought there were gaps in the information that they were telling me and was really uncertain of what the steps were, what was going to happen in the future.
And where is your case up to now?
I'll pass over to my solicitor, Sarah, to answer that question.
So we're preparing to fight the decision that the insurer's made to decline liability for Katrina's neck injury. And we're looking now at filing proceedings in the Personal Injury Commission on her behalf. We're seeking compensation for her for the cost of all the medical treatment that she's had to incur for the neck injury since the beginning of her claim, and then also the permanent impairment that the injuries have caused her and some compensation for the permanency of the injuries.
And to both of you, what resolution are you hoping for?
Acknowledgement. I hope to win.
Yeah, to win. Yeah, to win would be great. I'd like acknowledgement that I had a genuine injury and if I can get some compensation as a result of having an impairment that I'm never going to go back to the life I had before, then that would give me some financial peace of mind too.
Thank you. Daniel, You're a lawyer who works on claims for injured workers like Katrina. You help people make common law claims. What are they and who would need that kind of help?
A common law claim is a claim for lump sum compensation that can, in Victoria, can be done 18 months after the date of someone's injury. And effectively, it's a claim for compensation if that person has suffered a serious injury in the course of their employment as a result of the negligence of their employer or a third party. So that compensation is effectively broken down into two parts if that injured worker has negligence in their claim. So the first part is what we call pain and suffering compensation, which can range anywhere between $62,000 to $636,000 in Victoria, depending on the consequences of that person's injury. And they can also claim potentially for what's called their economic loss, for their loss of earning capacity. If they have a 40% loss of earning capacity, which can range anywhere between $64,000 to approximately $1.4 million in Victoria for someone's loss of earnings.
Tina, you're a phlebotomist. That's a person who does blood tests.
Yes, that's right.
And you tripped on a trolley one day while you were at work, mm-hmm. and you injured your neck and your shoulder.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
That was 3 years ago.
Yes.
How is your injury now?
My left arm, which I'm left arm dominant, I get pain shooting down my arm. I can't feel three of my fingers. And I have some neck disc issues as well. So I have been told that I require an operation for my discs. I'm still debating on that as to whether I want someone in my spine.
Understandably. Mm. You initially made a work cover claim, Tina, but that mm-hmm. took a long time to get any money. How long?
Yes, well, I actually went to a lawyer, which I didn't really want to, and started a work cover process, basically, of filling out the forms and doing everything. I was told that it would take 3 months without any money whatsoever. I waited the 3 months. It was still another month before anything was done.
Given the delay, how were you managing financially at the time?
Got a thing to say that I would take my home and I rang the lawyer that I thought I had, and he told me he couldn't help me for 12 months until I'd been on work cover for 12 months. So I kept going with the process and everything. I saw a surgeon about my shoulder, and he gave me a card for my lawyer. And since then, Daniel was there for me every minute. It's it went a lot easier. It shouldn't have had to be like that at all.
Daniel, is it common for injured workers to see this long delay in payments from insurance companies?
Yeah, absolutely. It's a common thing that we quite often see when representing injured workers. The biggest delay that we see in dealing with work cover clients is the delays in payments being processed, such as weekly payments. An issue when someone's on weekly payments of compensation is that their wage is actually reduced. Mm. So they're paid at a reduced percentage and at a reduced rate to what they were earning prior to their injury. So that's one issue in the process. But the major delay that we see with dealing with work cover clients really comes down to accessing their treatment. So quite often, major delays that occur around surgery requests, procedure requests, requests for medical expenses to be reimbursed. These are some of the major delays.
Yes, you worked with Daniel here too to make a claim for pain and suffering from your injuries. What was the outcome of that?
We managed to close the case with a positive outcome, but regardless of the outcome, the compensation will never give me my full health back.
Tina, you also reached a settlement. Mm-hmm. Legally, we can't say how much you got. Did you think it was enough?
No, definitely not. Daniel did point out to me that I could have actually kept fighting. It'd be another year, but it's another year without income, being able to move on or whatever. So I did settle. No amount of compensation, although thank you, Daniel, for helping me, and that is ever going to get that back, ever. It's your life is completely different, and not only financially, you don't trust anybody anymore.
Daniel, what do you think about the amount of compensation that injured workers can claim?
As both Yash and Tina have said, there is no amount of compensation in the world that can ever give someone's health back. Nevertheless, that financial compensation that people are able to access is something that is able to help them with their future. Although, you know, it's obviously nothing compared to what they potentially would have got if they were kept working full time. In terms of the compensation scheme itself, I mean, my personal opinion, I actually think the system is actually a fantastic system when you compare the work cover systems around the world, because regardless if someone's had an injury at work, doesn't matter if it was the fault of their employer or not, they're still able to claim work cover benefits. So in terms of the level amount of compensation, no, it's not always going to be you know, efficient for everybody, but at the end of the day, it's a system that we have got that allows people that have suffered an injury at work to be able to claim compensation.
I think today is when we realise how fortunate I am to have such a fantastic employer.
I've got hope for actually having a future for myself now, and it's all because I reached out for support.
All my hair fell out within a month. Mum was vacuuming hair out of my crib.
The eyebrows is the kicker. That to me was the most stressful part, is losing that identity.
I would spend evenings alone researching miracle cures.
I've pretty much tried every drug that's out there.
I just didn't want to become a bald man.
Juan, hello. You moved to Australia from Colombia with your wife Vanessa just 2 years ago. What was life like there for you?
Era muy buena. Nosotros éramos profesionales en Colombia. Yo era profesional en logística y ella era contadora.
And Juan, what were you hoping to do when you came to Australia?
Nosotros queríamos mejorar nuestro nivel profesional y mejorar nuestro inglés.
You started work as a contract cleaner to support you and your wife. You were injured on the job. What happened?
Tuve un accidente en un carro de limpieza que para limpiar el parqueadero de un hotel. Yo le reporté a mi jefe que el carro no, los frenos estaban fallando, pero él no mandó a revisar el carro y yo tuve que trabajar al otro día y me estrellé contra un muro de concreto y me rompí el cráneo.
Vanessa, you happened to be with Juan that day. What did you see?
Yo escuché el accidente y corrí a encontrarlo y lo encontré en el piso sentado contra la pared y había sangre en la pared y en el piso y la máquina estaba volteada y dañada. Y solamente él gritaba de dolor y estaba muy confundido y yo estaba muy asustada, estaba en shock y no sabía qué hacer.
Juan, what were your injuries and how were they treated?
Los doctores me tuvieron que operar el cerebro. Porque tuve sangrado en tres puntos de este. Toda la parte frontal de mi cerebro murió porque todo esto lo tocó la sangre. Y ellos trataron de recuperarme poniéndome en coma 10 días porque la presión del cerebro era muy alta. Entonces ellos revisaron que también tenía una fractura en mi dedo derecho, en mi pulgar y en mi hombro. Y después de esto estuve en rehabilitación en el hospital aproximadamente un mes.
Juan, before your injury, did you know there were systems available here to help people who are hurt at work?
No, no lo tenía claro porque yo conozco las leyes laborales en Colombia, pero no en Australia.
And because you were on a student visa, you were told that you couldn't access the help that's here. How did you afford all this?
Fue sumamente difícil porque yo no podía hacer nada, básicamente porque estaba postrada en una cama. Estaba tratando de explicarle a los doctores cuál era mi situación, qué era lo que había pasado. que había sido el accidente, explicar todo cuando tú no puedes hablar es muy difícil. Y fue difícil porque mi esposa tuvo que vivir la parte más fuerte emocional mientras yo estaba en coma prácticamente sin poder hacer nada.
Thank you. Daniel, who is eligible for workers' compensation here?
It's clearly defined in the legislation who is a worker. Someone who's doing 80% or more effectively of their work for that particular employer will be covered under the legislation. There's other things like, for example, if someone's a sole trader or if they work for themselves, as long as that person's got work cover insurance, they effectively will be covered under the Act, under the workers' compensation scheme.
Juan, how is your health now?
Ha sido la parte más difícil afrontar mi salud porque estoy sumamente medicado. No puedo manejar los ataques de ira, se me dificultan. Y mi cuerpo se siente agotado en todo momento. No puedo prácticamente... Hay mañanas en las que ni siquiera puedo levantarme de la cama.
Vanessa, I can see the toll it's taken on you as well. This must be incredibly hard for you and you must feel quite alone.
Nosotros no tenemos más familia acá, en Australia. Aparte, yo llevo un año acá y cuando llegué ocurrió lo del lockdown. Entonces fue más difícil por el impacto económico.
Juan, how has this affected your life and how you look at your future?
No sé qué pensar acerca del futuro, porque siento que el ser humano puede ser una fuerza positiva. Podemos ser positivos. Creo que debemos cuidar de los demás, creo que debemos cuidar de la naturaleza, creo que debemos cuidar del planeta para que todos estemos bien y tengamos una vida feliz. Yo ya afronté la muerte, estuve 10 días en coma y ya sé lo que es la sensación de morir. Y yo quiero que todo el mundo sea feliz con lo que ellos sueñan, con lo que los levanta de la cama y vivan una vida feliz, es lo único que quiero.
Juan, you're working with a lawyer now. What are you both hoping for?
Yo estoy esperando que se haga lo que es justo. En el mundo tiene que haber justicia y la justicia es lo que nos guía en nuestro camino de la verdad.
You really wanted to share your story, even though it is so hard to be here with your injury. Why is it important to you to share that story?
Porque siento que, más que allá de la comunidad latina, siento que el ser humano tiene que cambiar para bien, para ayudar a todos los demás y ayudar a todo lo que nos rodea. Siento que es muy importante.
Thank you, Juan. Thank you, Vanessa.
Thank you.
Yash, you're no longer in the fast food industry. How are you feeling about your new career path?
Could have never imagined I'd be where I am today. I'm in a more corporate environment now, and the way they treat me and their employees is so different. And some simple things, when some days I'd feel sick and, you know, just the thought of, oh my God, I can't make it into work today. Just that fear of being treated the same way, but having a complete different response just makes it so much better for me. Seeing photos and, you know, the stitches that I had on my face or the 8 months that I couldn't move my arm, I'm still living with those things, but I've actually got hope for actually having a future for myself now. And it's all because I reached out for support, because I asked for help. And I don't think that it's actually out there enough for people to know that there is help out there, and they just have to ask for it.
Thank you, Yash. Katrina, what does a working life look for you right now?
I work casually for a not-for-profit charity organisation specialising in end-of-life care. They tailored a position just for me with my abilities or lack thereof, and I absolutely love working in that space and the greater vision of helping these people at the end of their life. It's a very different picture to what I had in mind before my injuries. I'm still in the thick of what's going on with WorkCover and legally, so it's an impossible question to answer what the future is going to look like for me financially. I'm just glad I'm surrounded by people who support me, and that means the world.
Thank you. Mary, do you think it's possible to get to a place where there are good outcomes for all, for workers, for employers, and also the schemes?
Absolutely. We know from landmark research from New South Wales, in fact, it's won awards around the world, that there are a group of people, some people, who need extra support, and they do better if they get extra support. So identifying those people early and helping them more early, and then removing the barriers that are put up for other people, is the core way that we can help people. The human and economic costs go together. They're often parallel. And that's the best way we can help people over what is a difficult time in their life and help them to both learn from the experience, because we do grow through negative experiences, but also to help them get back to function.
Anita, you're now back at work on light duties. How has that been going?
Good, and I think today's made me realise how fortunate I am to have such a fantastic employer, that my light duties has been a really meaningful job. I've got out into community engagement and I have actually really, really enjoyed the role. I've felt worthwhile. It's kept me engaged with my colleagues, but made me feel worthwhile as a person, and that I'm not just another number. I can do this and I can get back to where I need to be.
You'd like to get back to full-time duties eventually. Yep. What would that look like for you?
Being back to being a paramedic in the truck, being the capable and not scared or anxious when the pager goes off, or worried that I can't do it, or having a panic attack while at someone's house. And I'm getting there. Not quite there yet, but I'm getting there.
Are you hopeful that that will happen for you soon?
Yes. I've got to get my shoulder to where it needs to be as well. And I'm still having treatment every couple of weeks with my psychologist with Ambulance Victoria for the PTSD. But I know that had I not had that specialised treatment with the psychologist, I wouldn't even be where I am now. So I will get there.
Good luck. Thank you, Anita. Thanks. Thank you to all of you for being here. That's all we have time for.